All right, we're going to continue our story of measuring different things about trees. And this time we're going to be measuring the change in the tree height over time. Okay, so we're saying that we took measurements for 5 years, four different tree types, and we want to see what this data means. Let's go to Insert Chart. And as usual, Google Sheets suggests the right chart. Okay, so there are other charts available. If you look at, let's say, a column chart, for example. Well, right off the bat, this one is just arranged incorrectly. So let's just switch the rows and the columns. And now this is telling the story of the tree growth. But with a column chart, most of the emphasis is on each individual amount, not the change between the amounts. So it's a little bit harder to see the growth patterns, let's say, for example, of the birch. But if you switch back to the line chart, you can see the birch moving here and the lines, which are taking up most of the space, is the change between the two points. Now, if you feel like these lines are a little bit close together, let's just move this over to the right and stretch it out a little bit. And there you go. It's even easier to follow that way. You typically want the passage of time on the x-axis and the values on the y-axis. And then when you go from left to right, which is the way that we're conditioned to read, at least in the Western Hemisphere, you'll see the changes as you move forward in time. Now, if you're doing this as part of a presentation where it's combined with other charts, you do want to take some time to make sure that the colors are the same. So in this case, let's just go to Customize and Series. And then if you need to change any colors, let's just say we wanted to change maple. You select that and you change the line color right here. All right, we'll assume that those are okay for now. But one thing that we do want to do is, probably don't want to call this birch, oak, maple, and sycamore. Let's just call it tree growth. One thing that you want to spend a lot of time on is just making sure that it's as readable as possible. So another thing that you can do is smooth out the lines, because as we talked about before, you're looking for the change between the two points. Well, it's not really a straight change, right? This should be a gradual change. So if we bring our chart editor back up, we'll go to Customize. And in the chart style, if you place a check mark in Smooth, it smooths out the lines. Now, another thing that you can do, and we will come back to this later when it makes more sense, is that you can insert a trend line. So if you left click on trend line, these lighter lines are showing the mean of the values. So it's putting in a trend to help you guess where it's going to be in the future. Right now, that just makes too much to look at. All right, so let's scroll down to this series of data. And you had someone that's kind of newer take these measurements. So you're going to see that there's a little bit more randomness in them. So we'll go to Insert Chart. Google Sheets knows to take this entire range just because I've selected at least one active cell in this range of data, right? And it guessed that we wanted a line chart, but in this case, we're actually going to go with something a little bit different. But first, we're going to come in and change the name. We'll say birch growth. So if you look at this, it looks kind of like a heartbeat, frankly, and it will lead you to assume that the growth in a birch kind of goes up and down, but trees don't get smaller, right? They only get bigger. So we want to illustrate this in a different way. We're not going to use a line chart. So we will go to Setup, drop down line chart, and come down and pick a scatter chart. So we'll left click on scatter chart and we'll make this a little bit bigger. We're trying to show you a little bit better what all these measurements mean without overemphasizing each measurement. And we're trying to de-emphasize the fluctuation between these points. So now let's go back to the trend line that we talked about earlier. Wasn't making sense when we looked at it at first. But if we left click on trend line, now you can see why you might want to do that. All right, so it cuts through all the noise and it tells you where the next dot is most likely to be. At least that's how I like to think about what it's doing. Now there are some different things that you can do with this trend line. Let's stretch this out a little bit more just so we can see the variations as we go through this. Right now it's a linear line, so it's going to put a straight line into here in the best way that it can fit it. But that may not actually be what's happening with the data. So let's do something I think is a little bit better, which would be a moving average. And then this will move with the data, but it should move less than the data. It should smooth it out. But it's still too jagged, right? So let's change the number of periods that it's using to calculate the moving average. And we'll just go through 4. It gets a little bit smoother. And we'll look at 6, and it gets a lot smoother. Right, so let's use that. And then this is shifted forward a little bit. So let's change it from trailing to centered. All right, so this is intended to draw the viewer to what is most likely the average. And I think this line is helping us to do that. All right, so let's do one last thing that's kind of fun. It's a little bit of an addition to charts, but it's a natural extension because if you look at this, maybe what you're trying to do is project what the growth is going to be in the future. So let's do that with a function. And we will go to the end of our data. And what we'll do, let's just say we're looking over the next several days, all right? So I'm going to highlight February 1st to February 8th. I'll go into the lower right-hand corner of that until the mouse turns into a plus sign, which means I can drag this down and just kind of put new values in there. It recognizes the pattern and it puts new dates. Now you'll notice it just redid the chart, but that's just because I have some of these values coming in here by using the random function. And that can recalculate what a random number is when you change things. So don't let that throw you off too much. But we are going to predict some numbers here. So we're going to look into the future and we're going to use a function called trend. And the help comes up and says, if you give it partial data, which is the historical data here, it's going to put new data out there in an ideal trend. All right, so what all this fancy wording is telling you is that it's going to use the previous values to predict future values. All right, so the first thing that it needs is the known Y data. So if you look at this graph, the Y axis is the height. So we will select this historical data of the heights because that's what's known. So that's what this function needs. And then it needs the corresponding Y values. So what dates do those heights belong to? We'll select that area as well. We'll hit a comma. And now it wants to know, well, pretty much in this case, what dates do you want me to predict this for? Okay, so it's calling that new data X, but it's saying, what days do you want me to predict in this situation? So let's highlight C82 to C89. And then just let's put in a true for the last value. Reading what that says down there gives me a headache. So just make it true. And there we go. So there's a prediction of these values given all the previous values. All right, so let's look at the chart. And I think we need to refresh this chart a little bit because it didn't pick those up. So we'll go to edit. Let's go down and look at the range. It now ends in 89. We will edit this chart and make sure the range goes all the way down to 89 now. Click out of there, and there's these new lines. So you can see now they're just based on mathematical prediction because they don't vary from the mean anymore. So is that exactly what's going to happen? No, of course not, right? There's going to be some variability in it, but this is the mathematical best guess. All right, now we're going to look at mapping geographical data using the built-in charts in Google Sheets. So it should be pretty fun. And if you want to check it out, I'll see you in that next video. Thanks for watching. It's nice to have you along.